like an eagle. There's no trouble that can keep you down. No heartache. No disappointment. All you've got to do is just wait.
Come on, some of you remember it. Horn section, help me. Oh, Lord, I need you to help me. Until my chain. On the side, come on. In the back, come on. Everybody rock like this. All the young people, get your hands up. All the young
people. I'm a friend of God. I'm a friend of God. I'm a friend of God. He calls me friend. Who am I that you are mindful of me?
Come on, everybody, put those blessed hands together and give God your best praise wherever you are. It does not get any better than that. Our young people this morning singing praises unto our Lord, that they know that they are a friend of God. Who are we that God is even considering us? Who are we that God is still even fooling with us? If you know that that is right, if you know and can agree with the understanding and wondering why God is still fooling with you, why God is still your friend, holler back at me this morning on this broadcast. Send me some emojis this morning. Let the world know that you recognize that the Lord has been shown up good with you and should have left you alone a long time ago with your no good self. Good morning to each and every one of you all. That's right. I said with your no good self. None of us are no good. None of us are deserving. Some may be better than others, but the truth of the matter is the Bible says that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And I'm just glad this morning that God is still calling us friend. This morning we have a wonderful worship experience planned for each and every one of y'all. It is Youth Sunday. So you saw our young people clapping up for our young people this morning. Give it up for our young people, our music ministry, our parents. Thank you so much. It does my heart well every time I see our young people doing the worship experience. Thank you, parents, for keeping them engaged in our music ministry. Thank you so much for keeping them engaged in Zoom and our Bible study. I know it's not easy. I know it's hard. I know it's a lot. And sometimes I know they may not want to do it. But trust me, the foundation that we are doing our best to help them to build will be beneficial to them, not only today, but for the rest of their lives. It is truly amazing what God does for his children. Look, I know some of you all were wondering what happened to me on Tuesday and Wednesday, but y'all didn't listen. I didn't say when we were coming back, but just we were coming back. So on this Wednesday, you got to get it, this Wednesday, our Tuesday call has gone away. Don't get upset, but I got something else for you all. Lord said to do something else. Our call, 6 o'clock on Wednesdays now, 6 o'clock on Wednesday morning, same dial-in number, same everything, but we on Wednesday will be having our war room on Wednesday. Terrific Tuesday served this purpose, but now we are shifting gears and we are going to the war room on Wednesday. And the war room is going to be a word from the Lord. The war room is going to be about the power of prayer and praying on Wednesday morning, a hump day, if you will, so that we can continue to advance along this journey and advance through the week. So the war room this Wednesday, 6 o'clock, Bible study is going to start back on the 20th. That's not this Wednesday, but next Wednesday. Amen. War room, Wednesday morning, 6 o'clock, Bible study, not this Wednesday, but the next Wednesday, where we will be back together off and running for 2021. Amen. I want y'all to pray mightily for this world, y'all. I want y'all to pray for this world, not just these United States of America, as oftentimes we ask the Lord to bless the United States of America. No, we want the Lord to bless the entire world because we're all interconnected together. It's a selfish attitude that we sometimes have that we just want blessings for ourselves or blessings for this country. No, we need the Lord to bless this world. We need the Lord to bless this country, every country. Need the Lord to bless every church, to bless every family, every one of you. You all, we laid one of our members to rest on yesterday, it's today because this is pre-recorded, but on Saturday we laid one of our phenomenal members, Sister Ruby Tucker, to rest in her home, celebrating her life, where she dedicated her life to the Metropolitan Baptist Church. And unfortunately we lost another jewel on last week, Sister Joyce Mason, who we will lay to rest on this coming Wednesday at 1 o'clock at the J. Wilkinson Funeral Home Establishment. You know, pray for that family, pray for our church, pray for the sick and shut in among your family, all those people across this world that's in hospitals, that's behind prison bars, that's struggling and going through. I know it may not be your testimony, it may not be your story, but you need, and I'm asking you to pray for other people. Pray for yourself, but pray for others, because some are really catching it, y'all. Some are really going through it. We're approaching almost 400,000 people that have lost their lives, losing almost 4,000 people a day to COVID. That is more than two people every minute to COVID. It is some rough time and some tough sledding. So stand by. Notices and announcements are going to come We have a wonderful announcement today that does my heart well. I am overjoyed. I am excited about this particular announcement. You're going to hear it here shortly. One of our sons of this church has acknowledged his call to ministry, and we are starting the process. But you're going to hear from him and how God has moved in his life and how he's decided to take that journey. So I'm excited about that. Y'all stand by for the notices and announcements. One more thing, y'all. Open up your hearts and minds. Open up your hearts and minds. You know, I always tell you all as a congregation, as a people, look, it's not my job to tell you what to think. I just want to make sure that you do think. That came from my beloved Dean Kenny. I want to make sure that you do think. And from our perspective, when I say our family perspective, Lady Chanel, myself, Angel, and Deja, God blessed us tremendously on this week that we were able to get the vaccine, our first shot. Of the vaccine. I know that messes with some of you all. I know some of you all have made up your mind that's not for you. And I'm not telling you what to think. And it's kind of amazing that I was actually on a webinar, a Zoom call with Dr. Fauci and the governor, big call for faith leaders, talking about the vaccine, how it came about, how it was developed. And we've been following this for a while, y'all, to try to understand, was it the best decision for us? And you all know with my wife, Lady Chanel being high risk, we want to do everything we can to keep her safe, to keep her protected. So for us, the decision to take the vaccine was a good one. I'm not telling you what to do, but what I am saying to you is do not close your mind. Do your own research. Do your own homework. I've said it before earlier this year. Do not be an echo. Be a voice. Stop repeating what you may have heard everybody else say and what everybody else may be doing, and you make an informed. Somebody holler back at me, informed. Make an informed and educated and a prayed up decision about what is the best decision for you. Because some of us are just saying what we've heard other people say. I know about the Tuskegee experiment and all of that. But sometimes, just like the Word of God, when it's taken out of context, it twists what actually went down, what actually happened. And when you compare that to where we possibly are today, it is very different. We got to come through this thing. The Lord's going to bring us through on his terms. But also we have to do what's prudent and what makes sense. So I say all of that to say that if you have the opportunity to take the vaccine, my family, all four of us, we took the vaccine. A little bit of pain in your arm for most of us, for me. But that's about it at this point. And we're just trusting and believing God that this was the best move for us. Search your heart, search your mind, and do what's right and what where God leads you, not where you lead yourself, not where you, somebody else has led you. You go where God, not based upon what I say, but based upon what you hear from God, not what you hear from yourself sometimes. All right, y'all, that's enough. That's enough. If you need a witness, I'm a witness. I took it. We're good with it, and we're moving forward with our lives. Amen. That's enough. Notices and announcements are coming. Special announcements about the call to ministry as well. I'll be right back. Y'all stand by, and then there's going to be a word from the Lord. Love y'all some fierce. I'll be right back.
Metro Church family, I pray that all of you are doing well. For many years, I have been here at this great church. I started my journey here as an 11-year-old boy, singing in the choir, standing on the doors of the church. I remember coming and seeing Pastor Bland preach for the very first time. The message was life-changing in such a way that it caused me to join. I have established many relationships with each of you. I constantly pray and keep all of you in my heart. Let me first say that I thank all who have nurtured and instilled great wisdom into me since the beginning. I also thank my grandmother who has prayed and covered me since being an infant. I would also like to thank my pastor, the Reverend Lamont Hobbs, for his constant encouragement and prayers. Jeremiah 29:11 says, For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. After much prayer, fasting, and yielding to the voice of God, I have made the decision to accept the call to ministry and preaching. For years, I have wrestled with the assignment that was placed upon my life. Trust, I know that this will not be an easy assignment. So I solicit your encouragement and your prayers. This next journey that I will be taking, I ask that you all not judge, but pray without ceasing. I love each and every one of you, and I thank you for being the amazing church that constantly keeps a smile upon my face. God bless you.
We have established 2021 as the year of courage and confidence. Our focus this year will be learning how to trust God in the toughest of times. This is the year you find your voice and we all grow stronger in grace. Our focus scripture for the year is Luke chapter 7, verses 18 through 19. Attention Metro Ministries, please submit all 2021 funding requests by January 15th for consideration. There is no established sacrificial giving amount for 2021. We just ask that all members and friends do the very best that they can. We understand that these are challenging times, but to whom much is given, much is required. And it's back, just on a new day with a new focus. The Terrific Tuesday Call will no longer be held on Tuesdays, but join us on Wednesday mornings at 6 a.m. for War Room Wednesdays, a midweek morning prayer call that will help guide us through 2021. Make the sacrifice to wake up early on Wednesday, and we guarantee you will be encouraged. Weekly Bible study resumes on January 20th at 6:30 p.m. Log into our YouTube channel and let's reason together. Let's study to show thyself approved, rightly dividing the truth. Teaching that takes you to another level. As a reminder, your diaconate ministry is on site to receive tithes and offerings each Wednesday from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. and from 5:30 p.m. to 7:30 p.m. Thank you for your continued support of this ministry. Social distancing and all other necessary safety precautions are exercised. Giving made easy. Tithes and offerings can be given online by visiting mymetroexp.org and clicking Giving. You may also send your payment via Cash App to $MetroExperience and be sure to include your first and last name in the For section. Lastly, you may stop by for drive-through giving on Wednesdays. Thank you for your continued support of this ministry. And last but not least, please remember to subscribe to us on YouTube and like us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. That's all for your announcements. And up next, get ready for a preached word from Pastor Lamont Hobbs that will energize, educate, and encourage you. Open your heart and mind to receive the word of God.
Let's go. The greatness of the Lord is inconceivable. The love that he shows is unconditional. The power. Oh,
that anybody's testimony that God is great and greatly to be praised? Thank you, choir, for stirring our hearts and soul. Thank you for the energy that you bring to the table on this morning. We are so glad about our beloved brother, Brother Deron McCray, minister in training, Deron McCray now, who has decided to take that step into ministry, who has decided to yield to the calling of God. Church, I want y'all to pray for this young man. I want y'all to lift him up. I want y'all to encourage him. I want y'all to share any resources you have with him as he takes this journey for the Lord, not for himself, but for the Lord, moving towards that time of his initial sermon and licensing here at the Metropolitan Baptist Church. He is going to be, and already is, a tremendous asset to the kingdom and kingdom building, and I'm just excited to be a part of it. Come on, y'all, grab your Bibles, if you will. Turn with me to our anchor text for this year. For this year, Luke chapter 7, verses 18 and 19 is our anchor text, but we're going to verse 23 on today. Luke chapter 7, verse 18 through 23. I'm going to read it for you here. And here it is. It said, the disciples of John the Baptist told John about everything Jesus was doing. So John called for two of his disciples and sent them to the Lord to ask him, are you the Messiah we've been expecting, or should we keep looking for someone else? John's two disciples found Jesus and said to him, John the Baptist sent us to ask, are you the Messiah we've been expecting, or should we keep looking for someone else? At that very time, Jesus cured many people of their diseases, their illnesses, evil spirits, and he restored sight to many who were blind. Then he told John's disciples, go back to John and tell him what you have seen and heard. The blind see, the lame walk, those with leprosy are cured, the deaf hear, the dead are raised to life, and the good news is being preached to the poor. And he added, God blesses those who do not fall away because of me. The word of God for the people of God. Go on and anchor yourself in the presence of God. You already know what the word is on this morning. If you've been paying attention, it is, Lord, help me to hold out. Lord, help me. Help us to hold out. Might we pray together? Our Father and our God, it's once again, God, that I stand here and adorn this sacred place. I stand here, God, in the midst of an empty sanctuary, but full of your Holy Ghost. God, I pray right now that you endow me with power, with clarity. Allow me to speak, God, not a good sermon, but one that's going to do us some good. God, we need a word from you. We need to know, God, how to move, how to navigate, and how to hold on and to hold out. Thank you in advance, God, for this word that's going to bless somebody's heart and soul. God, I just get to tell the story, but you get all of the glory. In Jesus' name we pray, all of God's children said amen. Beloved of God, it is kind of amazing, kind of enlightening and even refreshing that you will find yourself echoing some of what your mother and your senior saints in your life have said. I find myself now very often repeating what my mama and what grandma said to me. And you just keep on living, as old people say, as our seasoned saints say, just keep on living, just keep on being afforded the opportunity to lie down and to get up, and you'll start talking just like the saints of old. It's a blessing, y'all, because they imparted some wisdom, they imparted some knowledge upon us. But you will find yourself, if you got any good sense, over the course of time, starting to say the same thing to your children that your parents said to you. Y'all ain't helping me right long through there. Is there anybody that recognizes and knows that some of that conversation, some of that wisdom that got dropped on you along the way, that you needed in a season like this? Because here's the reality. This season that we're in is something that we've never seen before. Out of all that we could have imagined, we are witnessing some times that we never thought was possible. And we have been going through for some time. We have been struggling through for some time. And I just came by to let somebody know and to help somebody to understand that every now and then, you just got to say, Lord, help me to hold out. is there anybody out there that can testify that there's a lot going on? There's a lot happening in this world, but we don't even have to go that far to the world. There's a lot that's happening in your life. There's a lot that's happening in my life. There's a lot that's happening in all of our lives. We look around us and we can see devastation and despair everywhere. We see everything that we thought was solid starting to collapse. We see everything that we thought that we could depend on, that it's not dependable. We are finding ourselves, even the very institutions that we held in high regard, the things that we thought were solid and could not be penetrated, have now been penetrated. It is a lot going on. We are witnessing some stuff, y'all. We have witnessed some stuff just on the past week that will make you shake your head. We have witnessed some people experience some things at the highest office in the land that we never thought we would experience. We have seen some of the hallowed halls of the capital of these United States desecrated and overrun, places that you thought were secure, places that you thought were held in high esteem and high regard. And God is doing something, y'all. God is up to something. And we are in a season, y'all, that we have to be able to continue to hold on to God's unchanging hand. Look, if you're going to make it through the next chapter of your life, if you're going to make it through the next season of your life, you're going to need the Lord to help you to hold out. Is there anybody other than myself that just want to throw your head back sometimes and scream? Is there anybody out there that sometimes you just had enough is enough? At some point, you've had it up to here. You stood all you can stand and you don't want to take no more. I wish I had some company right there that would testify that I need the Lord to help me. I need the Lord to stop by to come see about you. You need the Lord to make a way for you. You need the Lord to work some things out for you. You need the Lord to pave some streets for you and to pave some paths for you, that you know which direction that you're going. Is there anybody other than myself that can testify that you have found yourself over the course of this season in a dark place from time to time? But I always tell our congregation, baby, you can go there, you can hang out there for a minute, but don't you unpack your bag, don't you live there, don't you set up shop, don't you set up permanent residency, because the Lord may allow you to go in, but God wants you to come out. That's a shout right there to somebody missed their shout. The Lord is determined that he's going to bring you out. But every now and then, we all fall into a place, in a position where we need some help from the Lord. Come here, John the Baptist, help us on this morning to understand how we can hold out under the toughest circumstances and conditions. Y'all know John the Baptist. I know you know him because we preached about him. We taught about John the Baptist. Jesus Christ himself said there was none more faithful than John the Baptist. Y'all know about John the Baptist. He wasn't supposed to be here. His mother and father were up in age and they didn't think that they could have a child, but look how God blessed them anyhow. Y'all know John the Baptist, that weird dude that lived out in the wilderness, wore camel wool and camel hair for clothing and ate locusts for food and wild honey. Y'all know John the Baptist, the one that was a Nazarite man, the one that kept the commandments, the one who baptized Jesus, good God Almighty, the one who watched the heavens open up and God himself say a word from heaven came down saying, "This is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased." That was that John the Baptist, the one that baptized Jesus, the one that saw the Spirit descend from heaven, the one that was faithful, the one that drew men, women, boys, and girls unto the Lord and unto this gospel, unto the kingdom. That John the Baptist. But here in Luke chapter 7, we find John the Baptist, that one, the one that was close to God, the one that was called by God, the one that was ordained by God, the one that was placed in a specific place by God. We find that John the Baptist to ask the question. He told and called two of his disciples, "Y'all better come get my mule down here. I'm getting a little excited already." That nabbit, look, he called two of his disciples and say, "Look, I'm gonna need y'all to go find Jesus, and I need y'all to ask Jesus, are you the one, or should we look for another?" Let me tell you, the background of what's going on. Let me tell you the context of this scripture, because John the Baptist has went about doing ministry. John has went about doing good. John has went about keeping the commandments. John has went about trying to live a right and a clean life. Can I throw this in the soup right here and stir it up just because it's going to make it a little better? Has anybody ever felt like God has left you? Has anybody ever felt like the Lord has betrayed you? You have been trying to do the best that you can. You have been trying to get yourself together. You've been trying to work on yourself. You've been really trying to hold the line. But every time you try to do better, somebody steps up and tries to get in front of you and take your blessing. Every time you try to do better, somebody talks about you or criticizes you or puts their mouth on you. You have been trying the best that you can, not working just one job, but working two and three jobs and trying to do the right thing and take care of your children, take care of your family. You've been trying to be faithful. I'm preaching better than y'all saying amen. You have been trying to be faithful, trying to change your ways. But at every turn and every angle, every corner, there is opposition standing there. And you feel like sometimes that all of the work that you're doing, all of the effort that you're putting in, all of the change that you're trying to make, that sometimes you feel like it's absolutely for nothing. Y'all don't like that type of preaching. Y'all like sugar-coated preaching, but I came to give it to you straight with no chaser this morning. Some of y'all would know what that means. I came to give it to you straight this morning that there are times in all of our lives when we feel like God is far from us and we need the Lord to help us to hold out. John in this text is locked up in prison, not because he was doing what was wrong, but because he was doing what is right. John is locked up because he spoke truth to power. He told Herod that, Herod, you're wrong, because Herod had married his half-brother's wife. And it was not according to the law for Herod to marry his half-brother's wife. And because Herod had some power and thought that he wanted to quiet John the Baptist, he threw John in jail and took John out of his environment. You miss your shout right there. John is accustomed to being out in the wilderness. John is accustomed to being out in nature. John is accustomed to being out in the elements. But Herod now has taken him out of his comfort zone, out from what he knows, and he had placed him in prison and placed him in captivity. And over a period of time, now John the Baptist begins to wonder and begins to doubt. Can I pause right there and give you my first point this morning? Look, beloved of God, even the strongest of us, even the most connected with God of us, every one of us at some point in our lives, we will have a moment. I don't care how brave and how bad you are. At some point in your life, you will have a moment where you will doubt the very essence of God. You will not know what God is doing, where God is. You will not be able to find God. And I don't want you to feel no type of way today if you mess around and have a moment. Holler back at me. I'm having a moment. I'm having a moment. All of us will have a moment. The Bible says that Jesus Christ himself said this about himself, said this about John the Baptist. There is none more faithful, none more better than John the Baptist. But here in chapter 7, John is having a moment. He said, come here, disciples. Y'all go find Jesus, and I need you to ask him this question, because I am catching hell right long through here. I need some honest folks out there this morning that will holler back at me and testify, Pastor, I'm going through it. I'm catching hell right now. It's tough right now. It is hard right now. It's difficult caught right now. It's challenging right now. And because sometimes we fail to be transparent, and our failure to be transparent keeps us in a dark place, keeps us in a dry place, because we are so proud. We don't want nobody in our business. We don't want nobody to know our stuff. But every now and then, you need to release it and let it go and let God have it. Is there anybody out there that needs to be set free this morning? Is there anybody out there that needs to have have a transparent moment that will testify right now that, God, I am catching hell. I am struggling. I am going through it. I don't understand what you're doing. I don't know how you're moving. I don't know what your purpose is right now. I can't even find you, God. I am in a dry place, and I need you to help me to hold out. John is struggling. He is in a dry place. And he sends his disciples to tell and to go find Jesus. And he asked Jesus. He said, y'all go find Jesus and ask him, are you the one? Because if you're not, I need something else to hold on to. We all have moments. We all have tough times. Just because I get the mic and the camera doesn't mean that we don't have some struggles in the Hobbs household. Just because I get the mic and the camera and the monogram shirt don't mean that we don't have no issues. We all are human. And sometimes we make people feel bad because they're going through. Sometimes we make people feel bad because they need to talk to somebody. We make people feel bad because they need to go to therapy and lay on somebody's couch. In this season right here, every one of us need to be laying on somebody's couch, and we need to be regurgitating and getting rid of some of the baggage that we're carrying around, because we are sometimes too proud to go get the help that's really there. Look, this is a tough season spiritually, mentally, emotionally, financially, socially. This is a tough season right here, y'all. Can we be honest and transparent right here? This tough season right here. It's a season that none of us has ever been through before. It's a season that none of us know how to navigate in right now. It's a tough season right here. And you don't have to play the role and act like you got it all together and got it all going on. Chances are, if you run into somebody else, they got some problems of their own. Good God Almighty. They may not be your problems, but they got some problems. Can I help you know how else to hold on? First point is, understand that we all have a moment. And I don't want you to feel no type of way when you have your moment. And you will have your moment. All of us will. Here's the second thing. Have your moment. Lord will help you to hold out. Because sometimes you got to understand that God is working even when you can't be no witness. That's a shout right there all by itself. That the Lord is working even when you can't be a witness. Let me try to fix it. Because see, John could not see what was happening. John could not see what Jesus was doing. John knew some of the stuff that was happening that made him go back to what he thought he knew. But he was struggling with doubt. He was struggling with belief. He was struggling with understanding what God was doing. He didn't understand what the Lord was up to. But sometimes, beloved of God, you got to understand that God is still working even when you can't see it. I'm a help you right long through here, because some of us got real, real upset about what we saw happen up in Washington, D.C. Some of us wanted to get suited and booted. Some of us were mad as hell about what happened up there in D.C. Yep, it was glaring. It was apparent. Ray Charles could see it. Stevie Wonder could see the disparity and could see the treatment and how black and brown people are treated, as opposed to my white brothers and sisters. Yeah, I said black and white, brown, all that stuff. And the disparity was glaring. You could see it. Even us as black and brown folk, sometimes we discriminate against each other. Y'all ain't saying nothing back to me, because there was a brother, y'all ain't helping me, there was a brother that was in charge of the Capitol Police. But because we don't believe that certain folk with certain of certain ethnicity act a certain way, then we treated them differently. But those of us who got upset about what happened up there on Capitol Hill, I'm going to tell you to stand back and stand out of the way, because God is doing his work. And it may not have been pretty. It was ugly. It was a malfeasance at every turn. But the Lord was up to something, y'all. It is a tragedy because people lost their lives and blood was shed at the United States Capitol. But I came by to help help somebody to see it. And you need to stand out of the way and allow the Lord to do his work. Because I told y'all several years ago, when the Lord came through 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, everything needed to be out of the way. And God was working even when we didn't understand it, even when we couldn't see it. God has been pulling the veil back on evil for the last 5 years. God has been exposing some stuff over the last several years. God has been allowing us to be woke to some stuff that's been happening for a long time, but we haven't been woke to it. And some things just have to happen so that God can do his work. What are you trying to say, Pastor? Stand out of the way. Get out of the way. Move, fool. Get out of the way and let the Lord do his work. I need somebody to know that the Lord don't need your help on this one. God is doing just fine. You may not can see it now. You may not understand it, but God is doing a new thing right there in the middle and the power center of what we thought was the most powerful place on the planet, the most robust place on the planet. God is tearing down strongholds, and God don't need your help. God doing just fine exposing the enemy. God is doing just fine showing us what the enemy has been up to. God is doing just fine showing the disparities. And sometimes you just need to shut up and go to your room, like I told y'all last Sunday. God is doing something that we never could imagine. You may not understood it 4 years ago, but now I understand it better by and by. God is disrupting some stuff. God is doing what he promised that he would do. And he said, I never leave you nor forsake you. He told Moses, Moses, get a good look at him. Moses was afraid. Moses said, they coming after me, God. They got chariots. They got sticks. They got weapons, and I ain't got nothing right here. He said, Moses, just stand still. Ooh-wee, and see the glory of the Lord. Can I throw this in the soup and mix it up just because it makes it better this morning? You just stand still and watch God work. Somebody holler back at me. Watch God work. Watch him work. God is working, y'all, and doing it in a way that we could never do it ourselves. Sometimes you can't witness it. You may not be able to see it, but God is working. It may not have materialized in your life yet, but God is working, y'all. God has done some things at that government center in Washington, D.C. that we could have never wrote the script ourselves. And I must say, ooh-wee, that when God turns you over, whew, to a reprobate mind, that means an undisciplined mind. Come here, Saul. When God takes his hands totally off of you and turns you over to yourself, you'll go crazy. And we are witnessing now God turning a wicked leader over to a reprobate mind. And come here, I need to challenge some folk that don't like that type of preaching. You ain't got to listen no more. You ain't got to dial up no more. Some of us have allowed politics. Some of us have allowed the rhetoric to poison our minds. Some stuff just don't make no doggone sense. Some stuff just is not even feasible. Some stuff is just not even logical. Some stuff is just not even possible. But some people have allowed their minds to be poison. But if you would just watch God work, the disciples find Jesus, and Jesus, they ask him the question, but you got to watch text right here because this is powerful right here. They find Jesus, and they ask Jesus the question. You'll notice in verse 20, Jesus don't answer the question. The Bible says that Jesus just keeps on working. He keeps on healing folk. He keeps on delivering folk. He keeps on making a way for folk. He doesn't ask. They ask him, are you the one? But he keeps on doing the work. Can I tell somebody right along through there that sometimes God will give us the evidence that will surely give us some confidence. God gives them the evidence before he answers their question. God gives them the evidence before he answers their interrogatory. He doesn't open his mouth. He shows them. And in this season that we're in right now, I came by to declare that the Lord is going to show you better than he can tell you. The Lord is going to show us better than he could ever tell us. The Lord is going to show us how powerful he is. The Lord's going to show some people how magnificent he is. The Lord is going to show some people how much in charge he is and how less of an in charge that they are. The Lord is going to show us some stuff in this season right here. But you got to hold on. And even when you ain't got no confidence, you got some evidence. Come here. Can I preach all of it up in here? Is there anybody that would testify that I got the evidence? Every now and then, my confidence will take a hit. Every now and then, my emotions will take a hit. Every now and then, my self-esteem will take a hit. But when I look at the evidence, when I look where the Lord has brought me from, when I look what God has done in your life, I've got evidence. Hasn't God always made a way? Hasn't God always come through for you? Hasn't God always kept his hand on you? Haven't God always shown up on time? Haven't God always brought resources when you needed them? Haven't always God healed you when you were sick? Haven't God made a way for your children? Haven't God kept your family together? Good God Almighty, I feel like preaching up in here. Has not God always, always opened doors? Hasn't God always, when there was no door, opened a window? Who wouldn't serve a God? But sometimes you've just got to throw your hands up and surrender unto the Lord and say, Lord, I need you to help me to hold out. I don't understand what's happening. I don't know what's going on. I don't know why I keep catching all this hell. But God, help me to hold out. Help me, God, to see my way. Help me, God, to keep it moving. Is there anybody that needs the Lord to help them? Is there anybody that needs the Lord to come through for them? Holler back at me. Lord, help me to hold out. There's too much going on in my life. God, it's too heavy right now. I knew when I signed up for this that some things would happen, but I did not know that it would go down like this. I knew when the virus started that it would be difficult, but God, I didn't think it would last this long. I didn't think, God, that I would lose my job. I didn't think, God, that I would lose my family. I didn't think, God, that I would be on the brink of eviction. Lord, help me to hold out. God, I'm about to give up. I'm about to throw in the towel. Come here, John. John said, I had enough. I've been here in this prison. I see the guillotine being sharpened outside my cell. They want my head on a platter. And I need to know, God, are you still the one? Well, I came by this morning to preach to somebody that no matter what you're going through, no matter how difficult your time is, he's still the one. He said, tell John that the blind receive their sight. Tell John that those that couldn't hear can now hear. Tell John that those that had leprosy are now cured. I'm still the one. You may not be able to get to me. Good God Almighty, I gotta throw this one in for free because it makes the soup real good. Look, you may not be able to get to Jesus, but you need to have some disciples that can. I'm preaching better than y'all saying amen. In this season right here, get you some disciples in your camp. Get you some people in your circle, because when you going through your moment, you need to have some prayer warriors on your side. When you going through your stuff, you need somebody that can get to Jesus. When you can't get to him, you need some folk that know how to get a prayer through. Good God Almighty, you need some folk that know how to find the Lord. You need some people that know how to get close to the Lord, because you will have a moment. I have some moment. I don't know what tomorrow may hold, but I know who holds tomorrow. I don't know from one minute to the next what may come down in my life, but I know beyond a shadow of a doubt that if I go there, whoo, and I got some people on my side that know how to connect with God, know how to call on God, know how to get in touch with God, that they'll pray me through. Is there anybody out there that had to be prayed through before? Is there anybody out there that had a moment and you couldn't even get your head off the pillow? You couldn't even open the blinds or the shades. You couldn't even open your mouth to pray for yourself. I am preaching to somebody right long through there. But you had some folk that sent up some prayers. You had some folk that sent up some timber. You had some people that were praying for you. You had some people that knew where to find the Lord when you couldn't find him for yourself. That's why it's important to stay in fellowship. That's why it's important to find you a good church. That's why it's important to have you a good pastor, to have you a relationship with God. That's why it's important to hold on to God's unchanging hand, because all of us at different points in our life would need and say these words, Lord, help me to hold out. Help me, Lord. Help me to hold out. We are living in some tough times, but I'm so glad that God still shows us who is in control. It's been a wild ride, y'all. You may not be able to see it now, but you mark my words. These Egyptians, get a good look at them, because you ain't gonna see them no more. Who would have thought that a black preacher from Atlanta, Georgia, and a Jewish young man from Georgia would end up tilting the scales in the political process and head to Congress? Who would have thought that in this season right here, after all that we've been through for the last 5 years, the hate, the rhetoric, the insensitivity, the disparity in treatment, both economically, emotionally, and policing, who would have thought that the folk that they had their eyes on were the ones that had more reverence and respect for this country than the ones that they thought did? That's not divisive preaching. That's fact, y'all. And some people may try to sugarcoat it. Some people may try to gloss over it. Some people say, let's move on and kumbaya now. But there's accountability. And God has been watching. And God has helped us to hold out. You may have a moment. I guarantee you will. I'm not selling you a false sense of reality. This is not prosperity preaching. This is reality preaching. It may get worse before it gets better. We may be doing this next time this year. I don't know. You, me, and all of us may have a moment. But God is working even in your moment, even when you can't witness it, and even when you don't think the things are going your way or they even fair in your life. Trust me when I tell you that no matter what's going on, I promise you that God is not going to let it last too long. God knows just how much you can bear. God knows just how much each of us can bear. And because of that, every now and then, we say, Father, I stretch my hand to thee. No other help do I know right now. No other help have I been able to find. Nothing else has been solid and consistent in my life except for God. It is the only thing that has been keeping us through times like these. But if you will just hold on and say, Lord, help me to hold out. Just hold on and watch the Lord work. You don't have to raise a finger or even get a hair out of place. God is saying, this one right here is on me. While you were trying to figure it out, I'd already worked it out. And what the enemy meant for evil, I turned it around, meant it for good. The disruption that the enemy was planning, God shut it all down. Because God has a way of humbling us. Because the Bible says, at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, and every tongue is going to eventually confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Hold on, my brother. Hold on, my sister. Hold on, young people. Hold on, millennials. Trouble don't last always. Help is on the way. As God does a new thing in a new season in our lives. Get in position and get ready, because God is up to something, and God is going to blow your mind. You might miss it if you get ready. Don't get ready. Stay ready. Stay in position to receive what God is about to send and the change that he's about to manifest here on this earth. May the Lord God bless you real good. Lord, oh Lord, help us to hold on.